So good afternoon to everyone. My name is Niharika and I'm here to present a review study on criminal profiling of cyber criminal. Now with the rise and use of technology and devices, IoT and etc., there has been increase in cyber crime. So the cyber criminals have an advantage over the other criminals in terms of anonymity, global accessibility, victim ignorance, etc. Coupled all these issues coupled with cyberspace issues, it becomes difficult to pinpoint at a particular perpetrator. So profiling could be an aid to contribute to assessing such perpetrators. So profiling simply means extrapolating information about a person based on characteristics or tendencies and to predict that particular person's future activities. So like Sudhanju sir mentioned, criminal profiling is being used as an investigative approach, and it is nothing but linking crime scene behavior to the demographic characteristics in prediction of that particular person's behavior. Now, I have tried and linked this particular topic to cyber criminals or cyber crimes. Okay, so here there is just a mention that previously there has been use of cyber criminal profiling in Jack the Ripper case and Adolf Hitler and many more. And this type of profiling did not come up or was not introduced in Quotum until 1998. So moving on. Cybercrime, so just terms to be familiar with. Cybercrime is nothing but a broad term that covers criminal activities that involve computer or the internet. Computer here could be used as a weapon or as a target. People who commit cybercrime can be termed as cybercriminals. Virtual crime scene, just like a physical crime scene, you may have a virtual crime scene and it can have its own setup and steps to be taken just like your physical crime scene. There is a term called a cyber trail. It is considered as a virtual version of signature left behind or the evidences left behind in the virtual crime scene. I will be elaborating this in one of the approaches. So since it is a review study, I have analyzed certain papers and researches and made an overall approach of how you can connect two fields, two independent fields. So yes, next. So the role of criminal profiling in cybercrime investigation. So basically, the motto of your criminal profiling is to identify and understand the criminal. So how, who, and what? Okay. So there are certain questions that can be answered. So how could be answered by the computer forensic investigation, and then why and everything, or why and the other questions could be answered by the approaches and the criminal the personality characteristics. So now here I have briefly mentioned, briefly studied two things, the approaches and the criminal personality characteristics. In your personality characteristics, we have the technical know-how. So for example, the previous slide. So in the technical know-how, we can have the degree of knowledge, the person's degree of knowledge in a particular software or snooping devices which he used to carry out a particular crime. So you can label the person as being sharp or intelligent, highly intelligent, or a person with high IQ. Then he can be termed as a strategic planner, a bully, etc. In your personality traits, personality traits are nothing but the inherent qualities or the makeup, personality makeup of a person, which are predisposed and which tend to which have a tendency to be on the criminal side. So for example, a person who is highly impatient or extremist behavioral people, then the insensitive people could be termed up. I mean, that particular category can come in your personality traits. Social characteristics, the influence of social settings in shaping the criminal mind. So for example, lack of social skills, low self-esteem, or self-worth, then the marginalization, radicalization, etc. All of these come in your social aspects or social characteristics, and then the motivating factors. So for example, monetary gains, the greed of easy money, greed for easy money, political beliefs, emotions, disregard for law, thrill-seeking behavior, etc. So these are certain characteristics which we can have and which have an overall influence on the approaches. Now moving on to the approaches, I have mentioned three, have gained insight of three approaches: inductive, deductive, and the behavioral evidence approach. So the next slide, brief for this in the next slide. The next slide, please. Yeah. So in the deductive approaches, we go from theory formulating, that is studying the crime scene, to hypothesis creation, and based on the observed evidences, we go into the conclusion. So, for example, when an investigator has assessed that the internet cache shows that a person has accessed a particular website for more than 100 times per day after executing a particular attack, so we can infer that this criminal has a tendency to be paranoid. So, and also, thus we can further conclude that this person may be unemployed or he works from home and he spends most of the time surfing on the internet, stalking and having or in search for potential websites to be hacked or attacked. Next, you have the inductive profiling. So, inductive profiling majorly helps for linkage between to the other crimes. So, for example, with the use of statistical data or comparison data, we can link one particular crime to the previously done crimes with the statistical data. So, for example, in this similar case of cyber stalking, a profiler can reach to the same conclusion that a person suffers from paranoia and is unemployed or works from home with the use of statistics and the previously known cases. So the next slide. Next, third approach is your behavioral evidence approach, which has four cases. Equivocal forensic analysis, which focuses on reviewing the case from scientific standpoint and objectively developing theories of the crime. Then next we have the victimology, which assesses the traits of the victim, such as the physical aspects, the gender aspect, the age aspect, the lifestyle, occupation, etc. Then we have the assessment of crime scene. Now here, the investigator may collect, or the profiler may also intend to work with the investigator and collect something called as cyber trails. Here I would like to mention in brief about cyber trails. So for example, you have the log files. Okay, so log files can act as the electronic fingerprints. So they are specific to a particular system. Then we have another example of cache memory. In cyber investigation, we have browser forensics. So with the use of keywords, we can determine or we can assess the motivation of that particular criminal, the criminal motives or the so-called modus operandi. Then you also have images and images metadata, video metadata, or file metadata. So for example, in cases of child sexual abuse cases. So with the help of the images metadata, we can infer further time stamping. Now this time stamping with the help of time stamping, we can assess the date of creation of that particular file or image, the modification, the accessing time, etc. So the frequency of accessing time the frequency of accessibility of that particular file can help to determine the interests of that particular person. So that was one of the example. And the fourth, the previous slide, the fourth criminal characteristics, which is used to determine both the behavioral and the personality characteristics, and thus build an outline profile of that particular person. So in the next slide, I have given, there has been mention of cyber stalker profile. So based on the previous steps, so for example, in the equivocal forensic analysis, the researchers were used to use the deleted emails, the internet cache, images, etc. And based on that, they found that 40% of the victims were ranged from this particular 21 to 30 age bracket. 75% were females. Okay, and with the assessment of crime scene, it is seen that with the use of Facebook and Twitter, social networking platforms, the stalkers will post threatening or hateful comments about their victims. So the crime scene characteristics, the criminal characteristics of the cyber stalkers were seen that they had used emails to proclaim their love for the victims, and it shows excessively needy emails and exploitative or intimate images attached. So based on your one of the approach, you can have a brief criminal profiling also. The next thing is a theoretical model of profile of a hacker. Hackers have been profiled previously. In my study, I have come across major hacking or hacker profiles itself. So this is one of the brief, profile. And this is basically a proposed profile in one of the papers. So there are two there are certain central elements. So you have the biological factors, you have the external environment. So in the biological factors, the genetic makeup, the medical history, etc., which have an implication on the intelligence. No, the previous thing, which have an implication on the intelligence and the personality of that particular person. Then we have another component, that is your external environment. In that, the relation, the upbringing of the family, the relationship between family members, the school environment, professional work, etc. All of these factors in combination with the with these five factors, so intelligence, personality, social abilities, the technical abilities, and the internet addiction, all of these factors coupled with the motivating factors, that is motivating factors could be any, so economic factors for financial gain, as an example, curiosity, boredom, revenge, etc., and the choice of victim. With all of these factors, we can have a profiling of method of attack, the effectiveness of the attack, the methods used, and the mode of operation of that particular crime scene, of that particular scene. So thus there can be a profile that can be made of a cyber criminal. Now, as a part of conclusion, I would like to say that profiling of a cyber criminal is legal. It is a criminal procedure, and you can have psychological methods to be applied in it. And yes, there are various drawbacks. So, for example, there are different types of crime scene. So, are we going to have different profiles for each crime scene? I mean, for each type of cybercrime. So these questions still have to be answered, because there has to be research based on that. And does this paper just sets a foundation for investigators to use and approve upon the collaboration of using criminal profiling in cybercrime investigations, or to assess a profile of cybercrime? Thank you.